Thank you. It is almost inevitable that there is a little bit of overlap with what has been said yesterday by my colleague Emily Thomas, who I also would like to thank. And I also thank my colleague Ingrid Dillo, who also has contributed to some slides of this presentation. It is, in deviation from what is in the program, it is more towards such a fair data assessment tool than that the tool already exists. There is so far only a prototype, that I would like to say in advance. Concerning myself, I'm indeed director of DANS, but perhaps you don't know that I was the PI of the DARIAH preparation phase project, and that currently I'm also the chair of CESSDA, ERIC, the General Assembly of CESSDA, which is the more or less the counterpart of DARIAH in the social sciences. DANS is an institute that serves both the social sciences and the humanities. That is perhaps an explanation for this partly hybrid role that we are playing. Our mission, the mission of DANS as an institute of the Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Dutch Funding Organization for Research, NWO, is to promote and provide permanent access to digital research resources. And we have a fairly long history if you also count our predecessors. The first predecessor of DANS was the Social Science Data Archive that was founded in 1964. And you could say that actually the mission of DANS is to keep data fair. To illustrate that, I want to go back a little bit into the history of DANS. When we were created as an institute in 2005, we were also tasked with setting criteria that digital repositories, including DANS, should comply with. And that was when we started thinking about what eventually became the so-called data seal of approval. In 2006, five basic principles were formulated that were the basis of the 16 data seal of approval guidelines. And we also thought from the very beginning, this is not going to work if it is just a DANS thing. It should become much more an international and enterprise. So the data seal of approval was designed to be given over and still is now being governed by an international board. Currently, there is now about 70 seals acquired around the globe by repositories, many of which, by the way, are within the CLARIN ERIC and also within CESSDA. But the data seal of approval has a strong focus on Europe. Right from the beginning, it was also clear that the data seal of approval would not be the only initiative that was taking place. I don't think we were really aware at that time that the World Data System also existed, that had criteria for its members to become a member of the World Data System, but which actually turned out to be fairly comparable to what the DSA, the Data Seal of Approval, was doing. And in Germany you had the Nestor initiative, and then there was also an initiative to create ISO certification for digital repositories. And those different initiatives, when they met each other, decided to work together and to create a certification framework. And I'm showing this because I want to return to this in the very end of my presentation, because there is now so many initiatives on FAIR going on and so many different approaches that I think that it will make sense to create something similar that happened at the level of the, let us say, the quality criteria for repositories, also to do something similar for quality criteria, because that is ultimately what it is all about, or FAIR criteria for research data, and try to place them in a kind of a framework. By now, by the way, there is a partnership with the World Data System. I'm not going into that. And the common requirements have been formulated by the DSA and the World Data System, and that is going to be named the Core Trust Seal. So the joint criteria for the World Data System and the DSA, and they will also governed by one single board. So in the future, if you have a repository, you can go for the core trust seal requirements. And as you can see, there is now two more of them. Many of the requirements of this core trust seal actually have to do with the characteristics of the data that are within the repositories, because that is also what those repositories realize, and actually it is also very close to what Dieter was presenting us concerning CLARIN, where also CLARIN has this awareness that they have a certain responsibility ultimately for the resources that are being kept in those highly distributed organism, you could say, with all those repositories and centers that are united within CLARIN. And without me going to attempt to read all this, as I have only 20 minutes and there's a couple of other things I want to say more on the actual fairness of things. If you had a chance to read a little bit there, you will see that many of the criteria for the repositories actually have to do with the quality of the data. Now, when the FAIR principles were formulated about 2.5 years ago for the first time as such, it is actually quite interesting that there is a very close resemblance to what the original criteria, or I should say principles for the data seal of approval were that we formulated in 2006, and the FAIR principles. The first one, data can be found on the internet, is almost literally the same as findable. And the second one, that data are accessible, is also literally the same. The third one is a bit different. The data seal of approval said in its principles data should be in a usable format, which is not the same as interoperable, but you could say it is a condition for interoperability. And the data seal of approval never said anything about the reusability. It was actually thought that the reuse would be the resultant of the criteria. That was what repositories are ultimately all about. You create repositories because you want the data to be reused. So that was the underlying assumption for all of it. Therefore, it was not specified separately, but it said something about that the data should be reliable, which is, of course, also not the same as reusable. But again, without data being reliable, it makes no sense to reuse them. And then there is an interesting, let us say, it seems almost a deviation. A data seal of approval said data should be, it should be possible to refer to the data, to cite them. And the FAIR principles, actually, when they were formulating them, there is a lot of talking about the citability, but ultimately citability did not get a separate letter. It wouldn't create such a nice acronym if you would have to have a place for the C as well. So the citability was put under findability in the FAIR principles. But actually what this might say is that if a repository complies with the data seal of approval, already quite a few characteristics of FAIR should be taken care of. Actually, again, in the same way as what Dieter was saying about the role that CLARIN is playing. But still, and I already put some questions to him when I got the opportunity, you could say that all data sets in a trusted repositories are FAIR to some extent, but some data sets will be more FAIR than others. And that brought us to the idea that it might make sense really to combine and operationalize the data seal of approval and the FAIR principles to have more detailed tool, so to say, to say something on the individual data sets that are residing in the repositories worldwide. And well, I think a couple of the things here have been said already by others. But it was very important in our mind also to keep it simple. In the back of our head was this repository that we are having at DANS, which already is containing now some 35,000 legacy data sets of the past. And we were thinking, yeah, who is going to ever look whether those data sets are fair or not? Or should we just have only the look ahead and look at future data? Well, I hope to show you that perhaps a combined approach is still possible. Also, I'd like to say that back in 2011, we started our first experiments with data reviews. There were no FAIR principles at that time, but it was simply an attempt to, could we formulate, let us say, the right kind of questions and ask data users to give their impression of the value of the data or the reusability of the data that they have been taking from the from our repository. And actually, in principle, that appeared to work quite nicely. Many data users appear to be willing to make such a review. And we also made it very simple for them. Cross some tick boxes, also have some qualitative remarks, of course. But that already resulted in first experiments, which is actually did work. It is accessible, but it's also far from perfect. We were inspired to do this way also by these websites like Booking.com that ask you to give a review for the hotel where you stayed, or for digital cameras where you have also reviews, user reviews of the product. Meanwhile, all kinds of approaches are springing up and have already been implemented that use badges. Badges that say also something on data that is somewhere. You have different systems, and even you could also consider that a badging system. It is, I think, a very well-known one, the 5-star deployment scheme for open data, devised by Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web. Which also use a kind of badge to rate data, in this case according to openness, which, by the way, I think is very close to a combination of accessibility and interoperability in the FAIR principles. Now, next thing that you have to take in mind is that when we're talking about... I wait till the coffee is in. When we're talking about fairness, FAIR criteria, it is important to know, yeah, what are you actually after, and in what stage of the research process are we? For instance, funders are increasingly asking, they have embraced, many funders have embraced the FAIR principles. It sounds, also because it sounds very well. I often doubt whether the funders really know what it is about, but it sounds good. And who is against FAIR data? Yeah, open data is already a bit more difficult for many researchers because they're not also always willing to share their data. But FAIR is more safe, so they're making FAIR requirements of data when you write a data management plan. For instance, the European Commission is doing that. I have there a risk alert because they are posing there now some 35 questions or so. And that is quite a bit of work. There is a relationship here to another, endeavor I'm engaged in, which is the formulation of disciplinary data, research data protocols, as I tend to call them, or let us say standard data management plans, in which also Parthenos is engaged, and I think you are going to tell us something about that also a bit after my talk, right? And then there is also people who want to make data FAIR, to have certain, how, if you have certain data, how can you make it more FAIR than it currently is? So what kind of things you could do to do that? But we were actually focusing on the thing in the middle, that is on the data that we already have, existing data that is residing in repositories. Could we make a kind of an assessment of their fairness by using also the users to do that? So we devised a badging scheme for that. And now there is a slide that you also saw yesterday that Emily Thomas, my colleague, presented. I'm not sure exactly how many of you saw that presentation, but I will go briefly through a couple of things. As I will tell you later, when we were trying to operationalize the FAIR criteria, we ran into a couple of problems, and that is why the R is red here, and you will hear a bit later on why that is. But here you see a brief summary of the difficulties we saw when we tried to measure the FAIR principles. It is a bit schoolmaster-like, and I'm not going to tell you all the details that are in this slide for findable and accessible. But there was some questions that were raised in our minds when we were trying to make those criteria measurable. And of course, they are not intended, perhaps, they were not originally intended to be measured. They were guiding principles to refer to. So perhaps the whole attempt is not, I would say, to criticize them for these reasons is perhaps also not just. Also, Dieter mentioned one of them, we call this the Droste effect, this recurrence that operates if you require data to use vocabularies that follow FAIR principles, then ultimately the vocabularies should also use vocabularies that follow FAIR principles, and so on. So how far does that go? That's just one of them. I summarized them in this slide. What we thought was difficult was that there is dependencies among the different FAIR dimensions, the different FAIR letters. It was not always so clear to how to interpret and to measure an individual criterion. There was no thinking by the people defining them that perhaps you could have a rank ordering of fairness from low to high, and that is what we wanted to accomplish. And sometimes we thought that the grouping of criteria under dimensions was disputable. And there is one that I want to mention here that has to do with accessibility and with licenses. If you look at the FAIR criteria, you see that the licenses are under the R of reuse. And we were thinking, why did they do that? Because licenses are also, user licenses are very often about, they are also called access licenses, they are about access. And I've debated with the original, the people originally devising the FAIR principles this at great length, and there is some difference of perhaps of opinion there, or what is better to do. It's as yet not resolved. At least it is disputable. Then the second is, although I do not personally find that is useful at the moment, but I often hear voices that we should need or want or add other dimensions or principles or criteria. Some people say, for instance, openness is a separate criterion. It's not in the FAIR principles. Although again, then you could say, what about access? Isn't open access like the highest level of access? But the original inventors of FAIR don't want to have that. About substantive data quality, this was mentioned yesterday in the discussion. Is that possible? Is it to say something about the accuracy of the data or the completeness, perhaps? That kind of stuff. And FAIR also doesn't say much about for how long data should be FAIR, so the sustainability. But this is perhaps an assumption or something that we could resolve at the repository level. And data security is also not included in the FAIR principles, and still it is an important thing. Three I already mentioned. I think that several FAIR criteria can be solved or taken care of at the level of the repository. And then the fourth general thing that comes up time and again is whether we need different criteria for different disciplines. Again, something that has not been decided yet or isn't very clear yet, but at least what is clear is that there is different tendencies. Now, I told you that we ran into problems when we tried to operationalize reusable, and ultimately we took the decision, and this was from another principle, not the FAIR principle, but the KISS principle, keep it simple. We move some of the individual criteria to the other ones, then we can at the same time solve also the dependency of different of the different, let us say, letters that existed. So we took a very pragmatic approach there, but not everybody likes that we did this. But it became simpler, and ultimately we then simply say reuse is the average of findability, accessibility, and interoperability. And so this is our somewhat simplified operational schema of how to measure the FAIR principles and how to assign rates. So findable will run from there is no persistent identifier nor metadata whatsoever to there is extensive metadata. Of course, there is also an identifier, persistent identifier, and rich additional documentation available. And we did something similar with accessible and interoperable. The presentation, I guess, will be accessible. There is also some other presentations already online where you can get this in more detail. But for the want of time, I'm not going into it here. And then the next step, that's what we have been working on the past few months, is to turn these things into a questionnaire, an online questionnaire that anybody could answer for any data set in any repository. And the prototype that you go from question to question, and then you for each, this goes for each letter, and you get the score for each letter, number of stars. And that will result then in a FAIR rating of a data set. The idea is that, and this is not, that will be the work, Eleftheria Tsoupra, who is here, will be working on this in the next half year or so, to make this questionnaire, to make it available on a independent website, like the Data Seal of Approval also has an independent website that provisionally is named FAIR.dat for FAIR Data Assessment Tool, and that will provide the access to the questionnaire, but that will also show all the ratings of all the data sets that have been FAIRified. And it will provide a badge that repositories can import in their repository, and also these are still mock-ups, but they could, for instance, then show next to every data set this badge of fairness, and of course the badge will then link to the review that is on the FAIR.dat website. That is how it is devised. Now, we also asked ourselves in how far could we make this automatic, and this gives an overview not of the original FAIR criteria, because I think they are not operational enough to decide on that as yet, but this is our operationalization in how far we think that can be automatic. And we think that for a couple of them there is subjectivity involved, and where there is subjectivity it is very hard to do this automatic. Where it can be done automatic, quite a few of them can already be resolved by the repository. For instance, the PID is usually not issued by the researcher, but it's issued by the repository, which has a certain deal with a PID organization. And so perhaps that doesn't need to be answered. We can fill that out automatically and so on. Now, also when we are currently now testing this, we first tested this internally, and as I'm speaking now, there is six repositories that said, we would like to test this mechanism and see whether that works for the data set that we are holding. And we're very curious to the outcome. We are expecting that by the end of the summer. But some of the problems we ran into is that it is fairly hard to assess multi-file data sets. Many data sets have a kind of a hierarchical structure in the sense that the data set is actually what came out of a research project, and it is a whole collection of stuff. And perhaps only one or two of the files in the data set are really FAIR, and the rest is like oh, and I cannot pronounce that word, auxiliary material. Also, it may happen that some of the files are openly accessible and others are protected, and all that kind of complications. And then the subjectivity is problematic, especially, and that is also, by the way, in the original formulation of the FAIR principles, that data need to have, what is it again, rich and accurate metadata or something like that. I think it is R1, if you look at that. And also the use of standard vocabularies. Dieter said that, oh yes, we are using that in CLARIN. And of course, yeah, they are, well, some are using it. And also perhaps for only some of the characteristics. What about a historical data set with 100 or so variables or fields in it? One is occupation, and you use for that occupation, you know, you use the HISCO, the Historical International Standard Code of Occupations. That is a kind of vocabulary. You can say, yeah, I'm fair because I'm using that vocabulary for one variable out of 100. How do you evaluate that? What even is a vocabulary? What is it? When is it a thesaurus, a knowledge system, an ontology? How does that go? There is no registry of ontologies or something like that. I think, by the way, this is a hole in the market, and we are already thinking of starting a project to fill that hole. And then, of course, DANS is not... Well, we started doing this on our own, but we are well aware that we are not the only ones who are thinking of this. And we are at least involved in three other endeavors. We are not in the Horizon 2020 Commission expert group on turning FAIR data into reality, but that is an expert group appointed by the European Commission, who is to come up, among other things, also with FAIR metrics on how to measure fairness. But we are contributing to that. Then there is a GoFair program going on, and there is a GoFair metrics group, very much consisting of the people from the life sciences with whom we are engaging and sometimes even almost fighting. And thirdly, there is within the Research Data Alliance, there is an assessment of data fitness for use working group that is also working on this. And these are only three initiatives. There are many more. Also, we are sitting here now with people from the humanities and some from the social sciences, but there is probably 100 or so more initiatives going on. One, if I have... I should stop. If I have, this is the one but last slide. So about the GoFair metrics group, I would like to say that they have identified 28 potential metrics on the basis of the original criteria. And these are their goals, and they are trying to formulate the metrics according to the table on the right-hand side. And I can say you, tell you, it is a hard, slow, and energy consuming process to get there. I think we are now at principle findability 3 of the 28. So I'm not sure that we are all going to agree even on this, and that's why I was thinking that perhaps it makes sense to create a FAIR framework in the same way what we did with the repository framework, in order to get at least the noses more or less in the same direction, but perhaps also with different levels of FAIR assessment. Perhaps some have higher demands than others. But perhaps the hierarchy isn't so nice. You could also think of a kind of building blocks of different, let us say, groups, and it could perhaps also be according to disciplinary groups like we have here, humanities, and even within the humanities we have different strands that may opt perhaps also for different ways of measuring or establishing their fairness. And this might also be a good mechanism to at least make sure that after 3 or 5 years we have something that we more or less agree on and that is acceptable to the funders as well. So that is what I wanted to say. Thank you very much for listening, and excuse me that it was a bit long.